Facing national play-by-play at every Western Carolina basketball game on the Catamount Sports Network. Tune in locally on WWCUFM, Power 90.5 in Cullowhee, 540 AM WRGC in Silva, 920 AM WPTL in Canton, or on ESPN Radio 1310 and 970 AM in Asheville or Canton. You can also listen anywhere in the world on WWCUFM.com, WPTLRadio.net, or by visiting CatamountSports.com. That's the Catamount Sports Network, the voice of Western Carolina athletics.
And we welcome you to game two of our doubleheader here on Catamount All Access. The Catamount men getting set to take on the Samford Bulldogs. And with Appalachian State well in charge of their game, and Chattanooga will lose, so that means the Catamounts can fall to the 6th or 7th seed here in the Southern Conference Tournament. What that means is a win would probably pit the Catamounts on Friday night against the Citadel. A loss, they would play the UNCG Spartans. But maybe the biggest storyline coming in today, Trevor, Trey Sumler will not play today.
Definitely a loss for the Catamounts. The leader, leading scorer, assist man, point guard, heart and spirit of the Catamount team. They're definitely going to have to look for someone else to step up in his absence.
All we know is that it was Coach Hunter's decision not to play Trey Sumler here today, whether that's for rest or team rules violation, that we are unsure of. But the Catamounts recently have been looking to someone other than Trey Sumler to score down the stretch, and it's been Brandon Boggs.
Brandon Boggs has been phenomenal as of lately for the Catamounts. Really emerged as a leading scorer on the team, averaging 10.8 a game off the bench. Good shooter, good moves. Someone you like to have on your team to put offense.
You look at the Samford Bulldogs, their hot hand, Rajan Kelly, who put up 25 against the Spartans Thursday night. How can the Catamounts go and try to contain him?
Well, most definitely you have to put your best defender on him. Someone coming off a game like that, you look to keep the roll going when you have a high-scoring game like that. So you just got to make sure you don't leave them open, let them get a good start. Usually if a player starts off hot, they're going to continue it. You got to make sure the first 5 minutes of the game is going to be interesting to make sure he's stopped.
So Trey Sumler, dressed but will not play, is what we've been told from media relations here. So we'll have to see how that plays out. But Tawaski King, going back to his play on Thursday night, second half of that game, he really started to take over, really plotted that run for the Catamounts. Mm.
Tawaski King, a great player on the boards, a great player down low for the Catamounts. As their one true dominant big man. He does a lot of things well, rebounding, defense, just a number of things, great player.
And for Samford, because of the Appalachian State win, you know the bye is now out of the question. A loss here tonight, you get the 5 seed. But how does that affect your mentality? Because if they were to win, they're still stuck in the same situation at that 5 spot. How does that affect their mentality coming into this ballgame?
Well, obviously, when you're looking at tournament seeding, you still want to try to get the best seed you can. It's still going to be an interesting road for the Catamounts and Samford as well. Because someone's going to have to face Elon and Davison, eventually both dominant teams. But being the 5 seed would not be bad for either of these teams, because you would have to wait to see one of those giants later as to seeing them first if you slip down to 7, 8. So this is a big game right here. It's going to be a hard-fought one, I believe.
Because of that game in Boone today, Appalachian State will lock up the four seed and the first round bye. Samford, also because of that, and tie-breaking scenarios, will fall into number five. Western Carolina can go to the six or seven as we hit at the top of the broadcast. So Samford with their seed set, does that affect how they want to play, or do they still try to get a big win here on the road?
Well, obviously you don't want to come out lollygag going into tournament time. You obviously want to make sure everything's in order. You want to keep playing hard because we've seen teams before take off when they have something locked up, and then that affects them in tournament play. So obviously if you're Samford, you still want to come out and play hard and try to get a win. They've never won in the Ramsey Center. That's another interesting fact. They have never won here. So, you know, if I was them, I'd come out and try to get a win here and make some history.
Samford Bulldogs have never won in the Ramsey Center. They are 0-6 against the Catamounts in this building. The Catamounts trying to secure that sixth seed here in what has been a year of firsts for Samford, trying to make another one here on the road in Western Carolina. So we are about set for tip-off. And really quick, Trevor, for a Catamount win, what is the big key for them here this afternoon?
Well, key win for the Catamounts, they got to force turnovers. Samford is not a great team. They don't have a great record when they're turning the ball over. They got to be active defensively, especially shutting down Kelly. They also have to rebound well. That is something they have an advantage in. They can do that, get more possessions, keep Samford from getting possessions as well. Then they have a good chance to win the game.
We will step aside for your starting lineups and your player introductions here on game two of our doubleheader, between the Samford Bulldogs and the Western Carolina Catamounts on Catamount All Access, presented by TV62. And with that, those are your starting lineups here this afternoon for the SoCon Showdown between the Samford Bulldogs and the Western Carolina Catamounts. A nice crowd on hand here on a Saturday afternoon. Pleasure to have you with us. It's cold outside, but we're going to heat things up here in the Ramsey Center. And for Samford, it's a very strong starting unit that leads this squad.
And they have a good all-around team, a couple of good scores. They rebound very well. The one thing about Samford that stands out, they don't have a lot of bench production. That bench only averages about 10 points a game. That'll be something interesting to watch as this game unfolds.
And we are just about set for tip. Tawaski King making his way to the center circle. Williams to jump for the Bulldogs. The officials check the alignment, and we are about ready for Southern Conference basketball, the season finale on a Saturday afternoon in Culloway. Tankowitz corrals the tip, Harrelson running the point guard duties as the starter, with Sumler out via coach's decision. Lob inside, double comes to King immediately. Now Ross, spin move, tough shot, can't get it to go. And Sinclair's out of bounds, but Trevor, early on we see Samford paying a lot of attention to big number 32 in the middle.
Well, it's important because looking around at the Samford team, they do have bigs, but Tawaski King is a talented low post player. It seems like they want to focus their attention on him early, make sure he doesn't get going. With most notably Trey Sumner not playing, Tawaski King now the leading scorer in this lineup statistically. So good coaching decision by the Samford coach, making sure Tawaski King doesn't get going in Sumner's absence.
And so now Samford will bring it into the front court. Kelly skips it inside. Double comes, kick out to him, pump and go. Kelly trying to create space, finds it. Shot off the front iron, no good, and Ross skies above everybody for the defensive board.
The high flyer, Preston Ross.
Sinclair looks to drive baseline, long skip pass, good defense from Samford in transition. Ross swings it over, Tankowitz, he'll try a triple, won't go, King the rebound, jump hook is good.
The soft touch.
And you hit the nail on the head for a big fella. He's really got a soft touch under the basket.
Soft, soft touch. Reminds me of George Gervin, the smoothness with the shot. I like that.
Nice little jump hook there. The Catamounts on the board first, 2-0. About a minute and a half in, but Samford answers as Williams gets the own bucket inside. And the Catamount defense is too easy on the low block. Lob inside, three people around King, and it results in a turnover. Samford on the break, kick out three, won't go. Williams again with a rebound, over top of Harrelson. That shot's no good, and here comes Sinclair quickly into the front court. Lost the handle, now King picks it up. And ball caroms off of Giffard. And some fast-paced action early on. Catamounts get away with a turnover on the missed shot on the other end.
Yeah, I like what I'm seeing so far from the Catamounts. A lot of energy in the building tonight. You can feel it, Kyle. This is going to be an intense matchup as these teams had a thriller last time they played. So I like what I'm seeing so far.
Catamounts lost down in Birmingham as Tawaski King again going to work. And if you're Samford, if you want to stop number 32, you can't let him catch it that close to the basket.
You cannot. Tawaski King got the ball right under the basket. You cannot give someone with that much skill and power the basket from right there. Number 32 going to have a hard matchup with Tawaski King down in the block.
So the big fell off to a good start with all four Catamount points here in the early going. And you could argue, Trevor, it was the start that sunk the Catamounts on Thursday night, failing to score for nearly the first 6 minutes of that ball game. They've come out nicely here so far this afternoon.
Yeah, definitely a change. You know, anytime you come out and you're not scoring into the game, it kind of gets your offense going and gets you stuck. You can't get started up. You know, that's not a way you want to start the game. I like what I'm seeing so far, a lot of ball movement, taking advantage of King's size. Good defense. We see Rhett Harrelson getting in there with the big man tying him up. Just I like what I'm seeing. Looks like we're seeing two different teams compared to the last game, Kyle.
A timely double team will force the jump ball. Samford will retain possession, but it will change the possession arrow in the Catamounts' favor next time around. And you do have to give the credit
open man slip
to the Catamounts. The way they were able to bounce back in that second half, they got themselves back into that ball game. And I think we've seen some of that momentum carry over early on here this afternoon.
Oh, most definitely we have. No, it's going to be an emotional game, I feel like, we're going to see here today. And should be a good one.
Harrelson looks to come off the screen. King slips the screen. Jumper won't go. Follows his own shot. Can't quite get the rebound. And Williams finally comes away with it. And when you talk about Tawaski King, that might be the most improved area of his game since he's gotten here. He has really developed a nice mid-range jump shot to go along with his inside play.
Well, Tawaski King is really, you can see the change in his repertoire, as to say. He's good adding that jump shot. As you see in the NBA, a lot of times players like Blake Griffin, they just have a lot of post finesse and they don't have jump shots. When you look at someone like Tim Duncan, who has it all, it's a good development out of Tawaski King.
Shot clock down to one. They got to get it away. Shot won't go. Doesn't matter. Timeout. Samford's coach irate. We lead to the first media timeout. Tied at 4, 15, 30 to go here in the Ramsey Center when you come back on a chilly Saturday afternoon in Culloway. And we welcome you back to the Ramsey Center as the senior cheerleaders get a nice round of applause here on Senior Day, and they hope to be cheering a Catamount defense on to another victory, and so far they've played pretty well, minus a few missed assignments inside.
Yeah, we're saying, I mean, it's a low-scoring game so far, Kyle, only 4 points, 8 total points in 5 minutes of play almost. We're seeing a good defensive battle so far from both teams.
Early on, both shooting percentages for these teams are down. Samford only 2 of 7 at 28.6%. The Catamounts 2 of 6 at 33%. So a tough shooting night here in the Ramsey Center early on as we're tied at 4. King, nice read on the pick and roll. Brown kicks it out. Harrelson for 3. In and out won't go, but he will go to the line. And the Cardinal sin is a defender. Foul a 3-point shooter.
Hey, Kyle, that's truth right there. You can't foul a three-point shooter. Three-point shooters are usually good free throw shooters. We'll see what Harrelson does at the line.
Harrelson, a 75% free throw shooter, will go to the line for 3 as he was behind the line in a tie game here at 4. First pops in and right back out again. But this is an area where Larry Hunter has even said that he'd like to see a little more for the Catamounts, finding a way to get to the line, especially when the offense is struggling.
It's important, as we saw in the women's game earlier, it's a good advantage to have getting the other team in foul trouble. We saw the Charleston women were in the bonus 10 minutes into the game. That's certainly something you can use if your team shoots good free throws to put points on the board. I can see what he's saying there.
Harrelson hits 2 of 3, so it's a 6-4 Catamount lead. Again, full court pressure. Samford finally gets it across, barely beat the 10-second count. Harrelson tried to draw a charge. Catamount defense scrambles nicely. Kelly all the way inside, kick out 3. Can't find the bottom. Sinclair the rebound. Another good defensive possession for the Catamounts. Sinclair, what a nice lob. King can't get the easy one to go. Loose ball. And we have a held ball. It'll stay right here. So good hustle by King after missing the easy one. So good hustle, and the Catamounts will get the ball back.
You can see Tawaski King kind of hitting himself in the head right there, missing an easy shot.
Catamounts back into their offense. As they work the outside, over to Harrelson. He'll try for three more. That one's short. And Samford pulls down the rebound. The game in Boone is a final. Appalachian State won 86-60 over Chattanooga. So both teams entered with a lot to play for, especially that first round bye, and App laid it on them at home in Boone, and also another final from the league. Davidson, an 83-48 winner against Georgia Southern entering tournament play. So the last day of the regular season, pretty uneventful if you're Chattanooga or Georgia Southern.
Very, 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 Kyle. Looks like they'll be getting some bad seeding there that they don't want, but that'll work out for the advantage of us and a couple other teams.
Yeah, Chattanooga with a win over Appalachian State, and if we were to win here today, they could have the two. Now, because of their loss, if they lose, or if Samford loses, that will push Chattanooga all the way down to the seven seed. So going from a first-round bye to a seven seed, a far tumble. If you're the Chattanooga Mocs.
Most definitely, Kyle. That's something like that is very drastic, and that's unfortunate for them. What can we say? That's a huge tumble right there.
Williams, a nice lay-in. Box for three. Buries his first shot of the game. And he has been a really nice sight for this Catamount offense. In games earlier this year where it seemed like Sumler had to do it all, Boggs has really stepped up as late.
He really has, and that three right there is going to be an example of what he has to do for the Catamounts to get a good win today. They need production out of Brandon Boggs from three and on the points column as well, and hopefully he gets it going right here, continues to keep rolling.
Wilson pulls it back out, 10 on the shot clock. Samford trails by three, takes Harrelson, nice help defense, swing it over, another three-pointer woefully short, and knocked out of bounds. It'll go to the Catamounts as Torian Bromitz now in the game. And we really saw him in a half of struggles in that first half Thursday. He put on a nice game, 6 first half points, and he really started to come out of his shell, and people that were at the game really started to see the talent that's inside of this freshman.
Torian Bromitz is a good player. We're starting to see a theme of reserve players. When they get time, they're starting to show their full potential. It was good to see that outing from him show what he could do.
The 6'7", 240-pound freshman out of Columbus, Georgia, as Sinclair couldn't handle his pass. So a lot of youth on this team, and one of the benefits with Sumler out here today could go, especially with Harrelson. He has experience running that point guard position in the starting role. It'll be the second time he's done that this year. So it gives you more depth going into tournament time. So it could have been strategy for Larry Hunter. We just don't know.
Most certainly, you know, we don't know what Coach Hunter's game plan was. But most certainly, it's going to give a couple guys that haven't been playing as much to get a chance to get some running experience before the SoCon tournament starts. And, you know, ultimately that may or may not, you know, be a good thing for them. Most definitely probably will be a positive, get them some experience and some minutes.
Wilson will pull it back out. We're tied at 9, under 12 to go here in the first half. And the key for the Catamount defense was to keep an eye on Kelly, who put up 25 in his last outing. He has been shut down in the early going here this afternoon as Samford gets a nice bucket inside. It's the inside of the Samford bigs that are causing problems defensively for the Catamounts.
Well, so far we've seen Tyler Hood, especially on offense, get a couple of in close range buckets and a three. He's looking to be productive right now, and that's going to be good for Samford as Kelly hadn't even started up yet, and they're still leading. So that could be trouble for the Catamounts.
Boggs dribbles in, foul called. It'll stay here with the Catamounts. We'll take a timeout. King checking back into the ballgame when you come back. 11-9, Samford leads, 11:05 to go here in the first half.
team seniors. A senior from Harrisburg, North Carolina, Kelby Fall. Kelby is accompanied today by her father, Chris Fall. A senior from Wahlberg, North Carolina, Ariel Lori Hedgepeth. Ariel is accompanied today by her father, Lori Hedgepeth. And a senior from Fayetteville, North Carolina, William LaVon Stewart. William is accompanied by his mother, Amy, his father, Robert, and his sister, Kenya Stewart. Ladies and gentlemen, your 2012-2013 Come On Dance Team Seniors.
Welcome back inside the Ramsey Center. Dance Team Seniors being recognized in that last time out. And Samford's bigs are doing a lot of the dancing early on the inside. A lot of nice post play. Williams and Hood really getting the job done inside offensively for Samford.
They're doing a good job down there getting active and offensively putting points on the board. They've been the main chunk of Samford's offense, and especially with Kelly not being able to start getting it going yet, and that's something good for Samford, a positive.
Hood and Williams have 9 of the Catamount or the Samford 11 points. Brandon Boggs knocks that one down. That'll be his 4th. He and Tawaski King both with 4 early on here in the Ramsey Center for the Catamounts offensively. Boggs hits on the 2nd. So a perfect 2-of-2 from the line. We're tied at 11. Already our 5th tie here this afternoon in what has been a back and forth affair between the Catamounts and Bulldogs. Williams loose again, and he throws it down. A nice offensive set, and Samford made him pay. Brown, he'll tee up the 3 ball. That won't go. Boggs knocks it away. Loose ball, Wilson finally comes away with it. And into the front court comes Samford. Kelly on King trying to exploit that mismatch. Help comes. And they'll have to reset the offense. Boggs in there on Williams. Shot clock down to 15. Grafford can't get it to go. Brown the rebound. And if you're Samford, I think you would have liked to try to execute either the Boggs on Williams or, as Boggs tries up a 3, in and out won't go. The Boggs-Williams mismatch or the Kelly-King. I would have thought Samford would have gone in one of those two directions with the mismatch they had.
Well, they had Tawaski stuck at Tawaski King stuck at the top of the key. It looked like I would have thought a one-on-one isolation would have been in order, but you see them pull the deep 3. I mean, it was a good look, but they just couldn't capitalize on that possession.
Tied at 13 on the jumper by the Catamounts. Another open look. That one won't go, and Grabbert has not been able to find his shot early on here this afternoon.
It seems to me like the Catamounts are almost trying Girard to shoot, because we see Tawaski King playing at the top on the defense, leaving him open. He hasn't been able to hit the last 2 open 3s.
Boggs can't clean up the offensive board. And Wilson again walking into the front court. Tanglewitz will check in. Next dead ball as we near the 9-minute mark. Blitz comes again. He'll drive this time, draws the foul, and he'll go to the line. We'll see who they call it on. But maybe he learned from the past 2 that he missed and tried to create a better shot, and it results in contact and a trip to the free throw line.
See, there again, Kyle, you see they left him open again from 3, and instead of shooting it, he took it to the basket and drew the foul. It looks like that may be coach's strategy to let Girard, you know, just float out there in 3-point land, see if he can hit or not.
Jaffard gets the 1st as Kenny Hall, Preston Ross, and Tom Tankiewicz all check in for the Catamounts. Boggs, Sinclair, and King will take a seat. But we have seen time and time again, Preston Ross more than able to fill that role on the low block.
Oh, yeah, Preston Ross, a definite high flyer out of Fayetteville, an electric player, very versatile. He's only 6'4", 6'5", but his hops make him seem like he's a lot bigger. A strong guy. He's really good down there in that block, even though he's undersized.
Hard knocks down both. The Catamounts will try to tie or reclaim the lead here on this trip down two. Hall fields in the high post. He wants to go to work. Left-handed hook off the window. And Kenny Hall, he's had a nice little spark off the bench the last two outings he's had for the Catamounts.
Kenny Hall with a nice post move right there, something you would see in a video game. I like that right there. That's good stuff, taking advantage early of his height.
A very athletic player is Kenny Hall, and he uses it to his advantage there. Again, we're tied at 15. Kelly in trouble, looking for help, and close to a five-second call, and it will stay with Samford, so they dodge a bullet right there. But great defensive pressure from the purple and gold.
Most definitely. We're seeing Samford not really much of a – we're kind of panicking when the Catamounts are pressuring them. We haven't seen good possessions out of them lately with when they had Tawaski King playing at the top, and now we see the pressure still being put on by the Catamounts, and they haven't been able to get good looks and possessions.
Shot clock down to five. Wilson has to make a move. He does, and he walked with it. And the Samford Bulldogs will turn it over to the Catamounts, and they will have the opportunity to take the lead here with about 8 minutes remaining here in the first half. Tanglewitz will walk it across the timeline. Spin move, looking to go to the rack. Now he pulls back out, gives up to Ross. Shot clock down to 15 as Hall catches in the high post again. Swings it over, Tanglewitz, nothing there shot-wise. Lob inside, Ross on the far side. Shot clock at five, Ross makes his move and makes a count. Give him the deuce on the post move.
Good take right there by Preston Ross on the one-on-one. Good possession, good basket.
Catamounts reclaim the lead for the first time since the 13-27 mark. Catamounts trying to follow it up with a stop as Williams looks for somewhere to go, and he slowed down a little bit with the athleticism of Kenny Hall on him defensively in the low block for Samford.
Most definitely Kenny Hall is a big man, but the way he moves is not like a regular big man. He's skinny, very versatile as well, quick. That's definitely can cause problems regarding the right matchup.
Preston Ross called for the foul. We'll step aside, see if the Catamounts bench can keep on stepping it up here in the Ramsey Center when you return to Catamount All Access presented by TV62. .08 to go, first half. Catamounts a 2-point lead. And we've seen offense really all over the place for the Catamounts in the early going, as only Brown, Brummett, and Tankiewicz have yet to score of all the players that have entered the game for the Catamounts. A well-balanced attack early on in this one.
It is, and when you name those players, Kyle, it's only a matter of time before Tankiewicz and Brown score, especially Brummett, a player coming in off the bench. His minutes will depend on how he's playing, but those two players right there, I see them scoring in no time soon.
Hood gets his ninth point of the ball game and ties us up at 17. Harrelson trying to drive on Wilson. Wilson went for the steal to no avail. Tankiewicz has a man all in his shorts, and Ross kick out Harrelson. Tankiewicz, a deep three, won't go. And for those of you who may not have followed the Catamounts closely this season, that is one that is well within his range, as we saw him hit one from way downtown on Thursday night.
Second was most definitely a fearsome three-point shooter. His range seemingly has no limits. He can hit from anywhere behind that line, Kyle.
Kenny Hall will pick up the foul. It's the team's fourth. 6:27 remaining here in the first half, tied at 17. Wilson, a nice inbounds, and that's the second time that Samford has burned the Catamounts on that slip play out of the stack formation.
And again, that's an interesting play. We saw that play on the Indiana game where they lost to Illinois, the slip screen on the inbounds. That's twice to see if the Catamounts can fix that in upcoming inbounds situations.
Harrelson takes a drive, jump stop, can't get the shot to go. Hall keeps it alive. Brown comes up with it. He tries to finish. Won't go. Ross the follow.
Preston Ross. Oh, my goodness.
Go up and get it and send it in, big fella, as he's skied for that one and emphatically ties us at 19.
My gosh. Kyle, that dunk gave me chills over here. Ooh, that's a collision.
And a big collision with Ross along with Russell Wilson. And he wants a minute. Samford's coach out looking concerned as Seltzer will come over to meet his player as he heads to the bench. As he got hit in the head. Ross, his second foul. And we will take a momentary timeout as they figure out who they want to sub. The officials going over toward the Catamount benches. They want to wipe up the moisture off the floor. But already we see a lot of physicality, especially the Catamounts really trying to trap the ball once it gets across half court in that trap corner.
Most definitely, they're trying to create turnovers from Samford. And which is one of the areas we touched on, that Samford sometimes gets wily in turning the ball over. They average about 14 turnovers a game, and they do not have a good record when turning the ball over a lot. Most definitely, Catamounts should try to take advantage of that today.
And another area we touched on in the pregame was the bench scoring. The Catamounts leading that department 7-2 early on in this one. So already, Larry Hunter's using his bench. He's not afraid to use it, and they're stepping up big time here in the first half.
Well, Coach Hunter has a lot of guys that can come off the bench and score and produce. You know, you've got Brandon Boggs, who's one of the leading scorers on the team. He comes off the bench and a flurry of others, opposed to Samford. Their leading scorer off the bench only averages 3 points a game. So most definitely that is a most huge advantage for the Catamounts in this game.
Boggs off the bench, averaging nearly 11 a game. He has 5 so far here this afternoon. Tied at 19, we're back underway. Samford with the basketball. Hood again, a nice drive, and this time he walked with it. As he got going faster than his feet could take him, and his coach not very happy as they walked to the defensive side of the floor. It looked like he got lost in where he wanted to go with the basketball once he made his move.
Looked like he panicked a little bit. It was a good move. He just traveled on it, Kyle.
Harrelson, hands Tankiewicz. The basketball and a little nylon as he hits from downtown. And a good sign if you're a Catamount fan is Tankiewicz hits the contested three, a well-drawn-up play that time.
As we said a minute earlier, it would only be a matter of time before Tankiewicz got going, and there it goes.
Samford with an answer of their own. That'll hit the back iron, no good. Hood, another rebound, so he is putting together a very fine first half for the Bulldogs. Williams swings it around, Kelly, Miller. They'll go around the horn. Miller will tee it up from the wing. That won't go. Another rebound inside and a foul as Heyman was in there getting the board for Samford. It'll be Tankiewicz's first foul as Brown will check in for Harrelson. And Mike Brown has really turned into the defensive specialist for this team, asked to do a lot of the intangible things, and he's really stepped up and delivered of late.
Well, Mike Brown, that's definitely, you want production from the freshman defensively. We see him locking up here. Just a great effort. We see the Catamounts forcing great ball movement out of Samford. They're not getting good looks that they want, and they have been struggling to score as of late. And Mike Brown, big part of that.
Sinclair skies for the rebound. Can't get the three to go. He would like to find his shot before SoCon turning time, but even though that outside shot hasn't gone for him of late, he still created a lot defensively with his speed and athleticism. That has really helped the Catamount team. And that's really what he provides you with, is a nice little spark.
Sinclair is definitely one of those guys that's a great all-around player. He contributes to a lot of things, points, assists, rebounds. He's everywhere all over the court. Just a great, versatile athlete, great player.
The jump hook from King won't go. Catamount still lead by three, 3.5 remaining here in the first half. And this is a Samford team who going into today had a shot at the bye, beat the Catamounts down in Birmingham. And you got to be impressed with the Catamount offense and the production they're getting with Sumler on the bench.
Well, I like what they're getting off the bench, Kyle, because in a game like this, especially with Sumler out, you need the bench to step up. And they're doing so very well.
Samford, another offensive rebound, trying to create second chance opportunities all the way to the rack. And he lays it in and off the glass. And Samford has gotten their share of second chance opportunities with the offensive glass.
Well, most definitely they have.
Sinclair swings it over for Brown. And now Sinclair calling the signals from the top. Lob to King in the high post. 10 on the shot clock. Looks to turn it around, and he got the pass deflected. Pass ahead all the way. Gifford got it to go, and he counted in a foul.
I think that's a bad foul call right there, Kyle.
Coach Hunter tends to agree with you. I think you would have rather the official under the basket blown the whistle, but instead it was the one by the Catamount bench. We'll take a timeout. Samford has reclaimed the lead, 23-22, coming down the stretch here in half number one from the Ramsey Center. Back to the Ramsey Center as Samford will go to the line looking to complete the three-point play the old-fashioned way as Gafar got it to go on the fast break, and he has really created opportunities since that shot wasn't falling from the outside. He's really taken it at this Catamount interior.
Well, Gafar realized he had to make an adjustment. The open threes haven't been going for him, so he's attacking the basket and drawing fouls, which is something, from a scorer's mentality, is an adjustment you have to make, and it's been working out so far.
Jafar is 0 of 3 overall from downtown, 2 of 5 from the floor, and a perfect 3 of 3 from the line. Sinclair will bring it across the timeline, trailing by 2. Brown tries to lob. Nice defense from Williams. King tried to get the ball. And Williams, a nice job deflecting the turnovers in front of the low post. Samford trying to extend the lead. Kelly's creating some space. Drive baseline, floater off the window, and he has his first points of the game. Samford has their largest lead of the day at 4. 26-22, we've gone back and forth here at the Ramsey Center. Boggs, a drive, trying to finish with the right hand. He'll go to the line, and he is so good on that one step and pull-up jumper that Samford might have respected it a little bit too much, and they gave up a lane to the rack, and now we'll send Boggs to the free throw line.
Very quick step and shot, Brandon Boggs, one of his go-to moves. We've seen it a lot over his years here at Western. Very skilled in the scoring department.
Connects on the first. Kenny Hall will check in for King. Harrelson will come back in for Brown. So we have seen a multitude of Catamounts run that point guard position today. We've seen Brown run it, Harrelson, and even Sinclair at times. So the Catamounts developing depth in a close game situation here at home in the Southern Conference.
It's always good to make sure you have other people that can step in, as we see right here with multiple people running the point guard position. It's always good to have someone who can back up. You
know? Swinging around under a minute and a half to go in a 26-24 first half contest here in the Ramsey Center. Kelly will drive. Harrelson almost picked his pocket. And now it's 10 on the shot clock. Sinclair all over Kelly defensively. He's really done a nice job on him. Kelly trying to create, can't create any separation. And Jaffard, I know his shot wasn't falling, but you have to have the awareness and put something up with the shot clock winding down.
Jaffard, he kind of looked like, from reading his face, he kind of looked like he wanted to pull it, but realized, you know, he had to make an adjustment. He wasn't feeling it and was trying to drive to the basket. You definitely see what the Catamount defense has him thinking from shooting the three.
The second time they have created the shot clock violation is Samford nearly over in the court. And a timeout called from Samford with 36.8 to go. So not likely that they can go for the 2-for-1 with only 1.8 second differential between a full shot clock and the clock right now. But if you're Samford, do you just run your normal offense here? Or do you try to extend and breathe out some of this clock a little bit?
Well, if I'm the Samford coach, I want to just run my normal set, go for normal offense. There's about 30 seconds left on the shot clock, 37 seconds about left in the game. Just want to get ready with a shot, you get a rebound, then that's when you go to the basket and go with aggression.
And it'll be interesting to see as the Catamounts should end up with the last possession here in this first half. If you're Larry Hunter, who do you try to facilitate that last possession around offensively?
Well, if you're Coach Larry Hunter, looking at the lineup on the floor, last shot, you must definitely look at Brandon Boggs, a great one-on-one player. As we talked about his one dribble, you know, going past you, I'd definitely give him the rock in a last-second shot scenario.
Miller will pull it out. They will breathe some of this clock. 8-second differential between the shot and game clock. Harrelson on Miller. They'll switch. Trying to get Kelly the basketball. Nice blitz from Hall. Forced a tough pass. Miller, a tough shot. Off the iron, won't go. Hall the board. And the Catamounts and Sinclair have it. 10 on the clock. Sinclair makes his move. Swings it over. They give it to Boggs with three. All the way to the window, and he's fouled. And he almost took out half the cheer squad and our camera operator, Josh, on the far side, but they get it to Boggs and he creates contact and he'll go to the line with 2.2 to go.
You know, as we had just said, you know, if they get the ball back, you want Brandon Boggs taking the shot. We can see him calling for it as they're coming down the floor, and a good move to get free throws. We'll see if he hits right here, Kyle.
Boggs will go to the line 4-2. Connects on the first and a chance to tie the game for the 10th time here in this first half. It has really been a back and forth affair all afternoon long so far.
Well, looking at the score, we knew it was going to be a close game, probably looking at the last game, which was a close back-and-forth seesaw battle. I like what I'm seeing so far right here. It's been a thriller. Hopefully it'll continue.
Second one rattles out, full court heave. Well short, so we will head to the locker room. 26-25, your score. Samford with the lead. Some were not in action, but the Catamounts have played pretty well without him here in the Ramsey Center. We'll step aside for the halftime festivities. Catamounts trail by one. We'll wrap up the first half and look ahead to the second when you come back. Catamount All Access presented by TV62.
Jessica. The Fairview Flyers are a performing unicycle team of 4th and 5th graders from Fairview Elementary School near Asheville, North Carolina. They put many long hours into mastering the sport of unicycling. They are under the direction of volunteer coaches Greg Cheatham and Ellen McDowell.
Down. job, girls. Good job.
From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the Ramsey Center as we get set for the second half. In the first half, Samford shot 42% from the floor, but compound that with five offensive rebounds, and they were able to take the lead, though a very narrow one because of this Catamount defense, and they've really made life difficult in the turnover department as they forced five first-half turnovers.
Well, most definitely you want to try to make the most out of a team that turns over the ball a decent amount. Samford with five turnovers. Hopefully the Catamounts can hope to get more out of them this half. I like the defensive pressure so far, though.
Samford from three-point land, just 1 of 13, and a perfect 3 of 3 from the free throw line. The Catamounts 8 of 24 overall at 33.3%, 2 of 10 from downtown, and 7 of 9 at the charity stripe. So Catamounts trail by one here. What are some things they need to improve on this half to come out on top here this afternoon?
Almost definitely looking at three-point shooting. First of all, the Catamounts are only shooting 2 for 10 from the three-point line, about 20%. When you look at shooters like Tankiewicz, you got Rhett Harrison out there that can shoot threes, Brandon Boggs as well. They get it going from there. This game could swing in their favor soon.
And the Catamounts so far have been a balanced machine other than Boggs, 8 points off the bench. He leads the Catamount scoring, but Tyler Hood with 9 points and 2 rebounds, he's put together a nice game, although the Catamounts have started to counteract with some good defense on him as well. Who needs to step up for Samford for them to end up on top?
For Samford, you got to look at Clyde Jafarit Jr. He's only shot 2 for 5 so far. He's one of their leading scorers, averaging 11.3 a game. He really can't get it going from three at all. He's 0 for 3 from there, I believe. And the Catamount defense have forced him to shoot threes, and he's not hitting, so he had to revert and try to hit the lanes and get fouled and get inside shots, which has worked for him a little bit, but he's got to get it going for Samford if they want to get a win. Also, Kelly had a slow start as well, but he's starting to pick it up.
And with the Catamounts and Samford Bulldogs, we have had a back-and-forth affair. We've had the score tied 9 different occasions, 5 different lead changes, and in a game that could come down the stretch, you got to look at things like free throw shooting. Neither team went there a whole lot. 9 times for the Catamounts, only 3 for Samford. So it'll be interesting to see how that stat will play out. And you got to take care of the basketball. If both teams have shown they'll apply full court pressure defensively.
They have. It looks like it's going to be a defensive battle here in the second half with it only being a 1-point game. I feel like we're going to see a lot of pressing and ball pressure from both teams in the second half. It should be a good defensive battle, and ultimately we're going to see who's going to be strong enough to pull it out, Kyle.
The Catamount starters will be back on the floor. Sinclair, Tankiewicz, Harrelson King, and Preston Ross. And we'll remind those of you that may just be joining us, some are not playing due to a coach's decision that he made earlier today. So, with that, we are underway. Samford with a basketball and a 1-point lead here in the second half. They'll swing it around. Underneath Hood. A good start as he gets the tip in and off another offensive rebound.
Good second and effort.
Samford adds that second chance point total.
And Kyle, we've seen Samford get a lot of second opportunities to score the basket, something they're doing very well here today.
And count it, and a foul as Ross again provides a spark. How many times have we seen P. Ross provide an energy boost to start a half or in a spot where the Catamounts really need a boost?
Well, Kyle, I can't even say it enough. Preston Ross is just an electrifying player. We see him drive and hit the and one play. Earlier that dunk he had gave me chills. He's just an electrifying player.
And he completes the three-point play. We are deadlocked at 28. The 10th tie here this afternoon. Sinclair picks his pocket. He's off to the races. Giffard had no chance to handle an athletic Sinclair. And Larry Hunter on his feet in approval. And a very nice play. And that just goes to show you some of the many things that 25 and white can do for the Catamounts.
James Sinclair is such a great player overall. Just so many things for the Catamount team. Right there on the strip, looking like Rajon Rondo stripping Rajon Kelly.
A nice take that time by Williams. Not a bad contest from Tanglewitz, but the pick and roll works to the advantage of Samford that time. A play that the Catamounts also use a fair amount with King in the high post offensively. Ross at the top. Now they'll swing it around the horn, trying to get it into King. Double comes. Doesn't matter. The big fella finishes inside off the glass, and good ball movement from the Catamounts getting it to him. And Trevor, we talk about the play of Harrelson running the starting point guard position. What's your assessment of how he did in that first half and so far in the 2 minutes of half number two?
First half, Brett Harrelson, I thought he did a pretty good job. He led the offense pretty well. They were only down by one at halftime, so you can't say that he didn't do good running the offense. But they had the ball swinging around well. He made sure the ball got to the hands of where it needed to be. The Brandon Boggs is the Tawaski Kings. He made sure he got the ball was where it needed to be, and that's really all you can ask of the point guard when Trey Sumner's not here to score as well.
And maybe more importantly for Catamounts, he has not turned the basketball over once here from that point guard spot. So he's been a facilitator. Only one assist so far, but you got to look at how many times his pass led to a Catamount assist as well. Kelly turns it over, and we mentioned the ball pressures. Kelly's set to meet Harrelson at half court. Tied at 32 with 17 and change to go. A nice pick and roll. Hall, a nice strong hands, and he lays it in. So a battle of the pick and rolls early here in the second half.
It's good to see Kenny Hall getting some playing time, put in some production. Good game so far from him.
Javard swings it around. Miller thought about a three. And Samford again will work it around the horn. Shot clock down to 10. Samford's got to do something. They've had a couple shot clock violations already, and now they turn it over. Two early second half turnovers for the Samford Bulldogs, and the Catamount defense has really come out with a lot of intensity and energy here in half number two.
Well, they really have. It seems like both teams are coming out energetic, but we see like the Catamounts are just coming out stronger, edging them out slightly. So we see them being very aggressive. It's Harrelson.
Harrelson, the triple, won't get it to go. The Catamount bench wanted it as they were all on their feet. Foul called, and I believe they'll get Mike Brown with this one. But even though Harrelson doesn't knock down the shot, phenomenal ball movement inside, outside, around the horn, and finding the open guy on the perimeter.
Well, if you're Coach Larry Hunter, you can't be ashamed of what your team's doing. You got to be proud of them. They're getting great ball movement, getting great shots, great possessions. They're not shooting as good as they could, but you know, it's a close game, so that stat kind of drops out. They're shooting 33% at the half. But you got to like what you're saying if you're Coach Larry Hunter.
Nice skip pass to Kelly in the corner. He'll drive. Nice skip pass back to Hood. He had it blocked. Kenny Hall with his athleticism stuffs it from behind. Ross, he thought about the triple. Now he'll give to Sinclair. And the Catamounts will set up the half-court set. Catamounts now with a two-point lead into Kenny Hall. Can he make another move across the top of the iron? Won't get it to go. Ross flew up into the stratosphere, but he couldn't get his hands on it. Out of bounds, we'll take a timeout. Catamounts have reclaimed the lead. Which way will the seesaw go next here from the Ramsey Center? Find out when you come back.
Official timeout. The NCAA is celebrating 75 years of March Madness, one of the world's most popular sporting events. The 2013 Men's Final Four will be held at the Georgia Dome in Atlanta. The NCAA is marking the 75th milestone by honoring all-time players, teams, and moments of the tournament. Visit NCAA.com/March Madness and learn how you can be a part of the celebration of 75 years of March Madness. Now, stand up and get loud for free March Madness t-shirts.
Welcome back to the Ramsey Center, and we'll reiterate on the fact Samford yet to win here in the Ramsey Center in their team's history. And while this team not a part of the previous six necessarily, how much does that start to weigh on your mind as we go on here in the second half?
It doesn't really weigh on my mind too much, Kyle. I don't think that that'll be too big of a factor going in here.
The Catamounts 4 of 7 shooting here in the second half, and they've compiled that with some good defense as they've already forced 3 Samford turnovers here in half number 2. And now make it a 4th offensive foul. Harrelson doing the little things. And that's the type of play that the Catamounts really like out of Rhett Harrelson. He makes a lot of veteran decisions as a freshman.
You gotta like what Rhett Harrelson's doing, Kyle. He's a spark. He was a spark off the bench. You know, obviously starting today in Trey Summers' absence. You gotta like what he's done so far. And players like that taking offensive fouls, certainly things that swing the tide of the game and add a little emotion. So you gotta like those little things that Harrelson's doing for you.
Catamounts working the ball around the perimeter, trying to get it into King. Samford fronts him. As King demanding for the basketball, Harrelson doesn't see him and had it poked away. It'll stay with the Catamounts. 9 on the shot clock, and Coach Hunter pointing out to Harrelson, hey, you had your big fella on the low block in the high post. Shot clock will go to 15 on the kick ball violation. So a 2-3 zone being shown from Samford. Now they switch it back into man. King inside, can't finish. Ross, a rim hanger, and they will call a foul underneath, and King will go to the line.
Preston Ross.
I tell you what, if King had put it up there a little higher for him, Ross might have flushed it on the alley-oop off the backboard, but King's fouled. He'll go to the line to shoot 2. And for a big fella, quite the free throw shooter is Tawaski King, near 60%, as I might have put the announcer curse on him as he misses the first here. But as we near tournament time, Trevor, we see Tawaski King at the line in that championship game against Davidson. He was 8 of 8 in the last 2 minutes of regulation and overtime from the free throw line. You can't ask much more than that out of your big fella from the stripe.
You really cannot, Kyle, because we see a lot of times, even in the NBA, big men are not notably good free throw shooters. And 8 of 8 for a big man of that stature, that's good. Can't ask for much more from him.
A very clutch performance by him in Asheville, where the SoCon tournament will reside starting on Friday. Shot won't go. Tip. What a tip as he skied above everybody. And I believe they'll credit the basket to Heyman as he was able to get a paw on it and not get in the basket. Samford still trails by 1. Boggs catches it in the middle. Dribbles his way out of trouble and misreads Brown.
Harrelson turns them around, says Boggs is still our ball.
As Boggs was going back defensively, so the Catamounts will inbound the basketball, 17 on the shot clock, with a 1-point lead early on here in half number 2. Harrelson looking, still looking, has to throw it into Sinclair, skies to get it. Brown right down the middle, knocked away, and it'll stay Catamount basketball as they try to get it to King in the low block. Hunter points out the shot clock, gets it 10. Brown will inbound this time on the far side. Harrelson will swing it around, shot clock down to 5. Sinclair looking to create, can't quite get it to go. He did a pretty nice job, though, there, creating space to get a decent look.
That's a good job, but kind of like a Kobe fadeaway shot. I've seen Sinclair hit those a couple of times. Good shot attempt, just didn't go down.
Lob won't go. Boggs, the rebound. Harrelson will swing it around somewhere, or Sinclair, rather, in the corner for 3. Boggs, the rebound. Boggs looking to create, lobs it back to Sinclair. And a foul called underneath as they were draped all over Tawaski King. Trevor, as Heyman was all over him on the low block.
Heyman, the battle between those two is interesting to me, Kyle, because they're both men of big stature. Heyman not as big strength-wise as Towoski King, but still not a little guy either. They're both going back and forth on the offensive and defensive end. Interesting battle.
Boggs will try the triple. That's off the iron. No good. Miller will run it down. So a long possession comes up empty for the Catamounts. And you mentioned Trevor Heyman at 6'3", 190 pounds. Plays a lot bigger than his size, though, for Samford. And he really is a versatile player for this Bulldog squad.
Oh, most definitely.
Kick out three. Pickles the twine. And Kelly starts to heat it up from the outside, and a good sign if you're the Samford Bulldogs.
That's exactly what Samford needs to get back on top. We've seen the momentum switching as this has been a game of many leads, changes, and ties.
Foul underneath as Heyman's in there again. I believe this one will go on Boggs. It'll be his first foul. And a two-point lead for Samford. King will check back out. Ross will come back in. So a small but pretty athletic lineup here on the floor for the Catamounts with Harrelson, Brown, Ross, Boggs, and Sinclair.
Well, yeah, I like this lineup too, Kyle, because this is a lineup that defensively can lock down. Defensively, we see Preston Ross getting the steal.
He creates the steal ahead to Harrelson. Boggs throws it down. And Ross is fired up, and he is pumping both fists, and he and Boggs absolutely love it as he about brought the roof down.
That was definitely a slam, Kyle. Great entertainment out here for the Catamounts.
And an and one. How about the answer from Samford as they go right to the rack? And that will take us to the timeout. Samford at the line with a two-point lead. When you come back, the rim will take a break. And we'll take it with them here on Catamount All Access, presented by TV 62. Back in the Ramsey Center, Samford at the line, and the resiliency of Samford after Boggs just throws one down on you on the fast break on a hustle play. Russell Wilson now will go to the line for a three-point play of his own, and a emphatic one and one that Samford really needed to help calm the tide of that Boggs dunk.
Well, it's definitely any time you get momentum shifting in a game like this where the lead is back and forth like a seesaw, Kyle. Any opportunity to undermine your opponent's momentum gain is welcome. And we see Russell Wilson get the and one, even though he misses the free throw. That still killed the momentum that Boggs had just generated by that huge slam dunk.
1-2-2 pressure applied for Samford. Ross will swing it around. Sinclair and the Catamounts immediately into the front court. So no harm with the pressure. And it looks like a 3-2 zone look. For Samford, Sinclair shoots over top of it, buries the three, give them all three of those. And good to see if you're the Catamount. Sinclair finding range from deep.
Sinclair, he doesn't shoot the ball too much, but when he does, it's usually good possession. He really can score when he wants to, as we saw in the SoCon tournament last year. In that championship game, he had 13 or so points, I believe. But Sinclair, he really can score when he wants to. We're starting to see some of that with Chase Summer being out today.
Again, the 1-2-2 look. As Ross actually tipped it into the basket trying to get that rebound, so he gives Samford the one-point lead. As the Catamounts again will work the zone, Harrelson drive out box. He gets pathway into Ross and an athletic finish. A right-handed underhand layup off the window. Give him two more.
Again, we're saying good ball movement by the Catamounts. Brandon Boggs finds Preston Ross for the easy layup. Good ball movement creates easy points.
As Russell Wilson handles, and Trevor, we've seen Russell Wilson, the football player at State Wisconsin, and NFL. Now with the Seattle Seahawks, we've seen him as the baseball player, the same guy. And now we got a Russell Wilson basketball player to throw in the mix as well.
I had no idea, Kyle Rush, that Russell Wilson was a bench player for the Samford Bulldogs. Russell Wilson is everywhere, folks. Good to see him out here playing today.
Ross tries a triple. Falls soft off the iron, and Wilson the rebound. A one-point lead. All the way to the rack. Offensive foul. Harrelson draws a second charge here this half. And Wilson trying to act like a football that time, plowing his way into the end zone, but Harrelson had position and draws the charge.
Those little things mean so much, Kyle, when you're in a close game like this and everything is close. A turnover like that generated by Harrelson take charge is so big in the momentum.
Sinclair comes to get the basketball. And now they'll get it to Harrelson. Still that 1-2-2 look. They get it across half court just in time. Brown tries to drive baseline. Skip pass almost intercepted, but knocked out of bounds as he tried to find Sinclair in the corner. And we saw Chattanooga have a lot of success defensively in that 2-3 zone. And Samford trying a 3-2 zone. But the Catamounts have executed offensively very well. A lot of ball movement, as you alluded to, Trevor.
We've seen a lot of ball movement. Easy ball movement accumulates easy points, you know, as most people say. And, it's been good.
Inside Ross. Can't get it to go. Brown the follow. A little floater in the lane. He gets it to go. The Catamounts regain the lead back and forth. We continue to go on a Saturday afternoon in the Ramsey Center. Pass inside, Hood on Boggs. Sinclair poked it away, and I believe it will stay with Samford, as I think Sinclair poked it out of bounds. But in a seesaw game like this, a close contested game, without your leading scorer against a good Samford squad, if you're the Catamounts, it has to give you a lot of momentum if you can find a way to come out on top heading into the tournament.
Most definitely in a game like this, Kyle, when your leading scorer is not playing against a good Samford team, if you get a win right here, this will be huge, because you got to look at it from the angle that we were without our best player, we still beat a good opponent. So then you got to think about optimistically, well, what happens when our best player is playing? That's going to do wonders for this Catamount team going to the SoCon tournament.
Preston Ross fights for the rebound, draws the foul, the sixth team foul for Samford. So the Catamounts will be in the bonus the rest of the way with 8.5 to go and a one-point lead. Inside the basketball goes Sinclair. Lost the handle, loose ball. Hood trying to get it out of there, and a tie-up. And I believe we will have a jump ball. The arrow will stay with the Catamounts. And Coach Seltzer for Samford calling his signals, and the student section doing their best interpretation over there on the far side.
The student section giving Samford's coach a hard time while he's trying to direct the players on the play calling.
It's all part of playing in the road in college basketball, and especially in conference for a season finale on a Saturday afternoon. Boggs takes a Sunday afternoon stroll down the lane and finishes with the left hand.
Brandon Boggs is definitely feeling it today, as we can see him get hyped after every basket he has hit. Definitely playing with a lot of emotion, something you got to like if you're Coach Hunter.
Boggs now with 12 points, but maybe what's even more impressive is the balance of this attack for the Catamounts. He has 12. Ross and King both with 7. Sinclair Hall have 4. You go down the line, Tankowitz 3, Harrelson 2. A lot of scoring from a lot of different people from the Catamounts as Williams puts it in.
And it's good to have a good balance like that, because we've seen some games where we'll have Trey Summer with 25, 30 points and then nobody else near him. And when you have a balanced attack, it's hard to stop everybody when you have one person scoring the majority of the points.
Sinclair, bang, for 3. A huge 3 for Sinclair. He's hit his last 2 from outside, and the lead is 4, the largest the Catamounts have had here this afternoon. Wilson hammered by Ross as he goes all the way to the rack. He'll shoot 2. When you come back, don't go anywhere. We got a barn burner here in the Ramsey Center. 49-45, Catamounts lead. Wilson in the line for Samford when you come back. Back inside the Ramsey Center, and we talked about the Catamounts shooting woes in the first half, only 33%. They're 10 of 20 and even 50% here in the second half, but 2 of 5 at 40% from downtown as they started to take the lid off the basket offensively.
Well, Kyle, offensively that's something that's great for them. It'll hopefully open up this game. We see them up by 4 right now. Most definitely getting some points and shooting a higher percentage is always going to be welcome from anybody's perspective in the game of basketball.
49-45, the Catamounts with that 4-point lead. And I beg your pardon, I thought Samford was going to shoot free throws out of the break. They called the foul on the floor. So Samford had inbounds from the other side of the basket. And now they'll have 27 on the shot clock, trailing by 4. And Miller, who shot an air ball in his last shot, is hearing about it here in the Ramsey Center. Miller, Sinclair all over him. We'll get to Kelly Harrelson on him. Skip passes. Harrelson got the deflection and a foul called. Ooh. A defensive foul. We'll see who they tag. It could have been Boggs, Sinclair, or Brown.
I was going to go to Brown.
It will be on Brown, his second.
Again, I don't like foul calls like that either. I feel like I should let the players play when it comes to stuff of that nature.
Samford again triggers the inbounds into Williams. Kelly comes to get it, and he had a little spark at the beginning of this half, but since then, Trevor, Catamounts have slowed him down as Williams again finishes in the interior. Williams now in double figures. Give him an even 10. Tyler Hood with 13. Leading all scorers for Samford. Boggs thought about the 3. He'll drive. Nice little Euro step. Can't get it to go. Gets his own miss. And he'll pull it back out and rework the offense. Sinclair wants the ball in the post. They get it to him. looks, kick out Harrelson. He'll try the three, can't get it to go. Too strong on that one. And with a 2-point deficit, Samford a chance to tie the ball game. Under six to go.
See,
Ross and Kelly getting tangled in. The officials finally had enough and they will whistle Ross for the foul. It'll be team foul number six, and maybe more importantly, Ross's fourth foul, and he'll have to go take a seat as Tawaski King checks into the ball game. So Samford will inbound the basketball. Both teams in the 1-1 bonus. Next foul in as we come down the stretch. Quick catch and shoot, won't go. Sinclair the rebound. Quickly into the offensive front court. Boggs right at Kelly. Can't get it to go. Tipped around the basket and knocked out of bounds. It'll stay. Nothing they'll call Samford basketball. As they say, Boggs knocked it out of bounds. Fighting for that rebound. 5.5 to go. And what has been a really good basketball game. Well played defensively, but the offenses have stepped up at times here this afternoon as well.
Yeah, we're seeing a lot of offensive output coming late in the game. This is good. This is good entertainment value. This is a great game we're seeing right here coming down to the wire. And as we see Kelly almost getting the backcourt, the defensive pressure hasn't waned either.
And with a shot clock at one, the Catamounts foul Williams driving to the basket. So a bit of a bailout there. That'll be Boggs, his second foul. And Williams will head back to the free throw line. Samford down two.
Williams is a 68% free throw shooter. You can live with this foul if he misses one. 68%, that's not very good, not too bad either as he misses it. So definitely the foul right there didn't hurt the Catamounts.
So it turns into a pretty good foul, as Trevor mentioned, as Williams misses the front end of the two. And connects on the second. So 1-2 from the line. Samford again applying pressure. They fake the give to Harrelson, now will give to Sinclair. As the Catamounts come into the front court offensively. Sinclair swings it around, Boggs. Ball fake to Brown. Now they get it to him, King on the low block. Double comes immediately. He turns the other way and is hacked and will go to the line. And a clinch of the fist as he heads the line. And Tawaski King has proven to be too much for the Samford Bulldogs to handle 1-on-1. And that time the double came. King, a lot of court awareness, turns the other direction and creates the foul.
Well, Tawaski King has really been doing a great job against Samford. They've had a double team in front since the tip-off of the game. He's really used it to his advantage and still has been able to thrive and be great offensively in this game.
King connects on the first. Catamounts now lead by two. With 4:38 to go here in the ball game. Second popped out on King. Samford with a rebound. And while the lead hasn't been much for the past few minutes, the Catamounts have been in control of that lead here in the last 5-6 minutes or so here in the second half. Sinclair on Kelly, a good matchup there, as is this one. Williams and King battling on the low block. Kelly drives all the way to the rack and he puts it in.
Kelly has been seemingly quiet today, Kyle. It's someone who averages close to 15 points a game.
But a lot like what we see out of Sumler a lot of times, he has the potential when the game's coming down the wire to really start to take over. We'll see how much the offense will facilitate through him. King can't get it to go. The iron unkind. Sinclair gets it out to Boggs. Thought about the three, now he'll drive. Jump stop turns, and they say he walked with it. And we will pause for one more timeout. 3:39 to go. We got a brand new ball game tied at 50. Don't miss the end of this one from the Ramsey Center between the Samford Bulldogs and the Catamounts here on Catamount All Access, presented by TV62. And we welcome you back, tied at 53, 39 to go. And Samford has shot the ball well, but it's been the turnover bug that's bugged them a little bit here in the second half. They now have 12 for the ball game, and really a large part why the Catamounts are deadlocked with them at 50.
Yeah, the Catamounts have done a good job at forcing Samford turnovers with the press, full court, and the zone defense. They're bringing out, meeting Samford full court as well. They've also double teaming the key players on offense, Kelly and Gerard, leaving him open to force some turnovers too while they're trying to get the ball moving.
Miller creates space, now finds Wilson in the corner. And Ella set it back up with 16 and rolling on the shot clock. Miller, what a play. Can't get it to go. Denied at the rack, and Wilson somehow comes up with the basketball.
That right there is heartbreaking that you don't get the rebound if you're Catamount, but you can live with it at the same time because it's forcing Samford to get another possession, set back up. Nothing easy.
Kelly again trying to create. Kick out for Miller for three. That won't go. Hood, the rebound. Wilson again comes away with a 50-50 ball.
Again, we see another opportunity for Samford to score. That's two in a row as they just beat the Catamounts on the board and get it back in a new shot clock.
Their third opportunity here in this possession and a game tied at 50. Swing it over, Hood, skip pass inside, Williams, and he's tied up. It'll stay here with the Bulldogs, 11 seconds to go on the shot clock.
That's a good effort by Mike Brown there, tying up the big man Williams, someone much bigger than him. Good effort to get the jump ball and save the score right there, obviously being outmatched. Good hustle right there by Mike Brown.
Samford will call timeout, and Williams with 11, Hood with 13. That has been where a lot of these points have come from, especially on the inside for Samford. But Kelly now quietly with 11 points, and we'll see what type of game do you think he will play and roll in this offense despite the success Samford's had inside. Does Samford key on getting Kelly the basketball?
Well, Kelly, he hasn't been scoring too much today. He's a little bit away from the season averages. Obviously, he is your leading scorer, one of your top scorers. And while at one point you do want to give him the ball because he is your top scoring threat, you don't want to go away from the guys that have you in the game and have you scoring, the guys who got you in this position. So if I'm coach, I still want him to be aggressive, but I'm looking towards Williams and Hood, the guys that have been scoring the most, to continue to keep us in the game because they have, you know, brought us in the game.
Now, if you're Coach Hunter, Preston Ross with four fouls, when do you bring him in here with 2:27 to go?
Well, obviously, Kyle, with 2:27 left in the game, four fouls, the way Coach Larry Hunter has been playing the bench, I feel like you can bring him in right now if you want. If he fouls out, he fouls out, it's going to hurt. But at the same time, you've had enough players come off the bench, Torian Brummett, Mike Brown. You've had players come off the bench that can produce. Kenny Hall, another big guy you can bring in there. I feel like you have enough players that can, you know, substitute for him with 2:27 being left in the game. So I feel like you can gamble and leave him in there. If he fouls out, he fouls out. Someone else can step in.
So Samford will have the basketball coming out of the timeout. 11 on the shot clock is this will be their third opportunity as they've already gotten two offensive rebounds and hustle plays from Russell Wilson in this possession. Kelly to trigger the inbound. Looking, still nothing. Finally finds Miller that comes right back to Kelly.
Sinclair in a mismatch with Williams. Williams wants the ball.
Kelly doesn't get it to him. Long shot from downtown. Won't go, and it doesn't hit the rim. As Wilson again was in on the offensive glass, but it doesn't hit the iron. It'll be Catamount ball.
And this is going to be crunch time coming down in this game as we see Samford is not a good team when trailing late in the game or in close game situations. They're 1-18. And obviously they have a terrible road record. They are 4-11 or 12, I believe, on the road. And when you're on the road, that's a tougher environment. You're not used to you're not at home, so you're not used to the goals, the setting, the crowd. So that obviously is going to play a role down here with less than 2 minutes left.
Samford on the road this season is 4-11. They're trying to improve on that. King, jump hook, won't go, off the iron, foul called on Samford, I believe. As it will stay here, and we'll have to see who will go to the free throw line. For the Catamounts, it'll be Brandon Boggs with 1:45 to go A 1-1 coming for Brandon Boggs, and I hit on it at halftime, Trevor. These free throws become more and more critical, especially in a 1-1 situation.
Well, very important, Kyle, especially 1-1 with less than 2 minutes in the game. It shows you who's clutching, who's not. We see Boggs brick this free throw.
He was 5-6 on the day. That makes him 5-7 from the line as he missed the front end of the 1-1. So the Catamounts come up empty. 90 seconds to go. Coming down the stretch here in Cullowhee, wild shot won't go from Hood. Kelly did not touch the ball that possession for Samford. Sinclair out to Boggs. He's backing his man down, lost the handle, and he fouls Wilson, who now he will go to the line for the Samford Bulldogs. And Wilson, a 65% free throw shooter, will have a 1-1 for the Samford Bulldogs. A tie game still at 50 with 1 minute, 15 seconds to go.
Wilson not a great free throw shooter either, Kyle, as we see, 65%. We'll see if he can make it right here. He's obviously in a different environment being on the road. We'll see if he's clutch right here.
Into the Cat House band. Wilson misses the front end. Both teams have chances with a 1-1 to break the tie. Both can't convert, Boggs and Wilson respectively. Approaching on a minute to go now. Tied at 50, down the stretch they come in the Ramsey Center. And what has been a defensive struggle here in the finale. Harrelson with the ball, 10 on the shot clock. Harrelson's got to make a move. Shot clock down to 5. Harrelson with 3, had it taken away, and Samford will regain possession. Miller out in front. Boggs slows him down.
That's obviously not a possession that you want right there if you're the Catamounts. You don't want the Harrelson ISO. You can see Boggs saying he wanted the ball.
And timeout taken by Samford now. Not to reiterate it, but some are not in the game. A coach's decision. And this would normally be the time in the game where the Catamounts would expect him to shine with 32.6 to go in a tie game. So knowing it won't be Sumler, who do you try to work this offense around? If you're the Catamounts, you should get the ball back with 32.6 to go and 27 on the shot clock for Samford.
Well, if I'm Coach Larry Hunter, if this comes down to the last shot, I might want Tawaski King taking it in the post because they've had a double team him. I'm going to try to feed him in the post. That's going to open up for somebody else. And maybe some last-second heroes for James Sinclair. We've seen him hit a couple of big shots today earlier.
Samford with the basketball. Tie game at 50, 32.6 to go. Your listed attendance here this afternoon, 1,807 on hand for the season finale here in the Ramsey Center, and they are seeing a dandy coming down to the wire. Miller with the ball. They get the ball to Kelly. This is where the Samford Bulldogs will want it. Kelly calls for the screen. Blitz from King and Slick. Swinging around. Miller is going to drive all the way to the rim. He can't get it. Boggs running into the front court ahead to Sinclair. Tie game for the lead. Can't get it to go. Harrelson fights for the rebound. Brown got it off. Won't go. We are going to overtime.
It's a good game, Kyle. This is a great game right here, Kyle.
Holy cow, Sinclair had a great look at it. What a hustle play getting the rebound from Harrelson. Brown off balance, couldn't get it to go. 5 minutes, extra frames, reset the clock. We got a 5-minute basketball game on our hand here at the Ramsey Center.
Hey, Kyle, I'm excited for what I know the fans are as well. This has been a great game. We predicted this to be a good game. Good game the second go around, but this one's been better than the first, an overtime game. Hopefully we'll continue to see some good basketball.
Samford 0-3 in overtime games, and they played in one Thursday night at Appalachian State. They lost in double overtime there. So 0-3 for Samford. Keep in mind they've never won here in the Ramsey Center either. The Catamounts, their only overtime game was on the road at Elon. So the fans here at the Ramsey Center wanted some extra time here before they kiss the regular season goodbye, so we got it for them. 5 minutes, tie ball game. Fifth seed on the line, or sixth seed rather, for the Catamounts in the Southern Conference Tournament. And boy, we're finishing out the regular season with a dandy, Trevor.
Well, the Catamount fans are most definitely getting a thriller in the last regular season game at home. Overtime games are always exciting, always excitement. And this game, with all the emotion and hard hustle and play into it, this has been a really great game. I'm sure the fans are enjoying it.
Ross with four fouls. Harrelson with three. That's the foul situation for the Catamounts. All others have one or two. Tyler Hood with three fouls for Samford. So something to keep an eye on as we go into the extra frame. And we will jump it up one more time here in the Ramsey Center. College of Charleston beats Furman at Furman 74-50. Davidson a winner earlier today. And Appalachian over Chattanooga, clinching that first round bye. Those are your scores from around the Southern Conference. We have a 50-50 tie as we head to overtime here in the Ramsey Center.
And again, Kyle, this is how you know this has been a great defensive battle. The Catamounts usually average 70 points a game. Samford, not too far behind. They're in the low 60 range. And these teams are at 50 points in overtime. It's been a really great defensive battle. And these two teams normally allow more points than this as well, so they're both playing above their season averages defensively. So this has been really great.
King clears the scoreboard and breaks the tie. 52-50, Catamounts lead. The big fella, a big deuce on the inside to start OT.
So Oscar King kind of reminds me of the big Aristotle, Shaquille O'Neal himself, in a sense, as we see him get a nice, easy basket underneath the hoop.
Can't be contained on the low block. One-on-one, Ken King. Samford trying to answer. Cross court, Wilson. Drives, now sets up Hood. Kelly will drive. He'll take the pull-up jumper off the back iron. No good. Loose ball. Williams runs it down for the Bulldogs. Miller will try the three. Won't go. Sinclair the rebound. And now if you're the Catamounts, it's all about extending this lead here in the extra session. Harrelson on the wing. Now King as the Catamounts set up their offense. 52-50 here in the extra frame. King inside. Double comes looking for help and nearly turned it over as it's knocked out of bounds. 12 on the shot clock for the Catamounts.
Right here for the Catamounts, you want to make sure you get a shot off, especially with it being overtime, 3:31 left. Make sure you get a good possession, good shot, because there's not many to waste in an overtime situation.
You got to take advantage of every opportunity you get. Lob in to Boggs. He sets it to Brown, 8 on the shot clock. Harrelson thought about the three. Boggs can't handle. 3 seconds, he's going to have to put it up. Boggs will. Can't quite get it to go. The rebound from Brown can't follow. Williams, a huge rebound for Samford, and they will have an opportunity to tie the ball game. And Trevor, I don't think we could have asked for a much better contest than we've had here this afternoon.
You really can't, Kyle. It's been deadlocked the whole entire game from the tip-off. You just really can't ask for a great game like that, as Williams gets a great shot to go over King and a series of others. You just really can't ask for a better game than this.
The drop step ties the game. No team is led by more than four all afternoon. 52 all with about 2.5 to go in the extra session. Sinclair into King. He's going to work again. Give it to the big fella and let him eat Samford for lunch here this afternoon.
Again, we see Big Towaski King using his advantage in the paint and get another basket.
12 points for him, 4 of those in overtime. He started the game with the Catamounts' first 4 points. He's done the same in overtime. 54-52, Catamounts lead back inside of Williams. He stepped on the line. Another Samford turnover, their 13th, and that might be a huge one with only 2:03 to go. Press coming for Samford, and now they back off as Sinclair fields the inbound. Timeout, Coach Hunter, under 2 to go, 1:56 to be exact. Catamounts a 2-point lead, and We thought this game might have hit its intensity peak with about a minute remaining in regulation. This place is boiling with emotions on both sides right now in this Ramsey Center crowd. If you're Larry Hunter, what are you drawing up for your team right now, Trevor?
If you're Coach Larry Hunter, in the last 2 minutes, you want to make sure that everyone understands their roles. You want to make sure that everyone knows that you need good possessions. You can't have turnovers. You can't have sloppy possessions, because you're not going to win ball games that way, quite honestly, Kyle. You want to make sure everyone knows what sets we're running, what plays. You make sure everyone knows the foul situations, timeout situations. You don't want any area uncovered, especially in a crucial game where seeding selection is at hand for the SoCon tournament. You're just making sure you go over every part of the game plan with your team so you guys can pull out a win in a close one.
So, a game reset for you, 54-52, the Catamounts with the basketball, the possession arrow in Samford's favor, both teams in the single bonus. So a foul that is not a shooting foul will result in a 1-1 for both teams, as both teams have 18 fouls here in the second period and in overtime. The Catamounts getting set to break the huddle, and if you're Samford, and Coach Seltzer, what's your message to your team? Down two, 1:56 to go. It's got to start with a stop.
Well, if you're Samford's coach, most definitely call it begins with a stop. You know, you want to tell the guys, you know, look, we're down. Don't panic. Don't be frantic. You know that they're putting good pressure on us. But you want to establish who the ball needs to go to. Williams has been scoring a lot lately. He has a good matchup with his size. Your main scorer, Kelly, has been off a bit lately, as we saw him struggling a little bit. So you want to make sure, tell them don't panic. We're still in this game. Don't worry. Keep your head up, and let's fight this one out.
Catamounts trying to avenge a 64-60 loss in Alabama earlier this year. Brown, high off the window, won't go. And now Samford, a chance to tie or take the lead with a three. 90 seconds remaining in overtime. Kelly with the basketball. Looks for help, finds Miller. Brown on him. Shot clock down to 15.
Looks like it's going to be another Kelly take.
And a blocking foul called on Towoski King. So now Kelly will have a 1-1, a 79% free throw shooter.
Right there, that's a I don't like that foul call, Kyle. That's a bad foul call, especially if you're the Catamounts, putting a good free throw shooter on the line in the 1-1. The shot clock was getting low. He was at the half court line. Obviously, you want him to have a bad shot selection, but I missed.
80% free throw shooter. Missed the first, but got it back and buried the deuce. Tied at 54. Now we have a whistle. As the official from the far side now comes in, and something on the floor. And I don't know if it's a piece of trash, contact lens, or what it was, but they'll take care of that. And we'll re-inbound the basketball with 1:08 to go, tied at 54 apiece.
And the good thing for Samford, and the bad thing for the Catamounts, Kelly hitting that shot could get him going potentially in this last minute. So look for him. It might switch up. You might look for Kelly to take the shot if it comes down to it.
Under a minute to go. The Catamounts in a tie game with the ball. King inside, get it to him again, why not? He can't convert this time. Williams the rebound. Tie game, they have a chance to take the lead for the first time in overtime. Hunter furious at the shot selection as he wanted King to gather himself before going up with a shot. 13 second differential between shot and game clock. Ball comes to Kelly, Sinclair on him. Calls for the ball, screen gets none. Kelly swings it over back to Miller. With five on the clock, offensive foul. Boggs fired up as he drew it, and Hood pulled a fishing hook on him that time and got drilled for it on the inside. Catamount basketball, 16.4 to go.
Well, that's a very close call, very questionable. If you're the Catamounts, you got to love it. If you're Samford, you got to hate that call, but you got to go with the ref calls.
That is Hood's fourth. Hunter wants to talk about the last possession, 16.4 to go. And a close call, but they've called a couple of those. They called the one on King on the blitz play. The Catamounts ran defensively. They called the block. And Kelly didn't hit the free throws, but he got the rebound and put it back in. And so now 16.4 to go. Trevor, your coach Hunter draw up a play for the Catamounts to try to win it at the buzzer in overtime.
If I'm Coach Hunter, Kyle, my final play, I'm going with two options. I either want Brett Harrelson inbounding the ball to James Sinclair, giving the Sinclair isolation. James Sinclair, a very underrated one-on-one scorer. We see Brandon Boggs, he's known for one-on-one scorer. Trey Sumner as well, who's known this game. But James Sinclair, he's an underrated one-on-one player. He's a lot of good moves. I would try to get a Sinclair iso or either feed Tawaski King with 7 or so seconds, see if he can get a good shot off.
Sinclair shoots it at about 40% from the floor on the year. King at 51% from the floor. And another guy I think you might have to look out for is Brandon Boggs. The way he has played of late, you might see the ball in his hands. All three of those guys in double figures today. King with 12 along with Boggs. Sinclair with 10. Tied at 54, 16.4 to go.
It's looking like Samford's going to put a little pressure on the ball. They might have hurt my play call, put a little pressure on Sinclair from the jump. We're going to see what happens with Tim left for that.
Clock down to 5, knocked out of bounds, and it'll stay there. 3.6 to go. Catamounts will inbound the basketball, and they'll have one more crack at it. Otherwise, Samford will go to double overtime for the second time in as many games. 54 all, and Samford defensively, as balanced as this attack has been for the Catamounts, who do you try to key on? I know they've gone to King in overtime, but if you're Samford, you got to be ready to see a shot from just about anybody.
Well, see, the good thing for the Catamounts, they have a lot of people on the floor that can score right now. That's terrible for Samford. But I'm Samford, I want to key in on Boggs and Sinclair. I might almost try to make Harrelson take the last shot, as he hadn't had a lot of shot attempts so far throughout the game. Hasn't really proven himself as a scorer. So I'm looking at trying to single in on Sinclair, Boggs, and Tawaski King. Let one of the freshmen, Harrelson or Brown, take the shot.
Trey Sumler not playing today. Normally you would think that's where the ball would go. Who's going to step up with 3.6 to go and try to win it for the Catamounts in overtime?
We're going to find out right here.
Sinclair inbounding the basketball, gets it to Brown. He'll put up the shot, in and out, hang on the rim, count it! The Catamounts win it!
Oh my God!
And they score and bury Mike Brown!
Oh wow!
Oh my goodness! What a win!
Oh wow!
What a win!
Mike Brown!
For the regular season to end, the ball popped out, went off the board, hung on the iron, and the iron was kind to Mike Brown.
Oh, wow. That is a great shot by Mike Brown. The rim was too kind right there. Oh, my goodness. That's something the Sports Center top 10 worthy right there. Great, Mike Brown, the freshman. That's just great stuff. You like to see the Catamounts get a win right here.
And great to see Trey Sumler leading the charge to Mike Brown. And he is all smiles. The Catamounts will head to Asheville with a huge win over the Samford Bulldogs as Mike Brown, a shot at the buzzer to win it in overtime. And Trevor, it doesn't get any better than this.
It doesn't, Kyle. That's a perfect ending to the game right there. Overtime rim roller. You cannot ask for anything better than that in a game that close of this magnitude that means so much with seeding in the SoCon tournament next week. And this is just a great game. One of the best games I can say I've ever watched, Kyle.
An emphatic ending here to the 2012-2013 season in the Ramsey Center. And Mike Brown, 1 of 6 all day long, 2 points for the game. And then he doubled it and had 2 of the biggest points of his career as the ball hung on the back iron and fell in for him in OT.
Hey, Kyle, that's just a great shot right there. I really can't explain. That's just something that's just electrifying. And you can see them rush Mike Brown rather than just celebrate. It's a hard-fought win from the Catamounts all the way around.
And how much does this do for this team? The way they won tonight, going to Asheville to play Citadel in the nightcap on Friday.
Well, Kyle, most obviously, this is so much for the Catamount spirits because Trace Helmer wasn't playing, and a lot of people got a lot of run in this game, a lot of experience, which obviously something that's good for your team in terms of depth and confidence. And getting a big win like this against a team, that is higher ranked than you, has a better record, a team that is a good team that was looking at a possible bye, that just does numbers for your confidence. They're probably going to do very well in the tournament.
And Samford will close out the season losing two overtimes. We will take a very quick break. When we come back, Trevor and I will have your post-game wrap-up here on Catamount All Access, presented by TV62. Don't go anywhere. Your post-game wrap-up is next.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Ramsey Center, where we had an overtime thriller. Your Western Carolina Catamounts winning on a last-second shot by Mike Brown, which took all day to go in. And your final score, Western 56, Samford 54. And, Trevor, this was a really low-scoring game. But I tell you what an incredible shot by Mike Brown there at the end.
Oh, man, Mike Brown. We had Kyle had asked me during the broadcast, he said, what does Samford need to do? And I said, well, Samford, they have to get the ball into the hands of one of the freshmen, Harrison or Mike Brown, and make them shoot. Obviously, with the floor being loaded with shooters like Boggs and Sinclair and King. And that's what Samford tried to do. But unfortunately for Samford, Mike Brown with the big clutch gene, craziest buzzer beater I've seen in a long time, the nice rim roll. that's just great stuff from Mike Brown on the great buzzer beaters. Catamounts get a good win here.
And the Catamounts had three players in double figures, Tawaski King, James Sinclair, and Brandon Boggs. A very balanced effort from the Catamounts. Preston Ross also contributed 9 of his own on a night when Trey Sumler did not play at all. And really, you talk about a team that needed rebounds. We mentioned rebounds earlier in the broadcast, and the Catamounts were out-rebounded 41-33. How were they able to stay in it despite getting out-rebounded by that much?
Well, the Catamounts, the way they were able to stay in the game, they moved the ball a lot, and they forced Samford to turn the ball over about 12, 13 times. They played great defense as a whole and as a unit, and they really forced Samford in a lot of a bad possession. We would see where Rajon Kelly, most of the time in ISIS situations, he was out here near the half-court timeline, and they weren't getting good looks and good possessions. And that's something that is great for your team defensively when the other team's best player is having to make moves from the half-court. That's not good offensive sets and good possessions. So the Catamount defense really, besides not out-rebounding their opponent, which they usually are good for rebounding, that was something they really did to offset Samford's offense.
And one other interesting point is that Samford had 14 turnovers compared to Western's 9, and points off of turnovers, Western had 20 points off of turnovers. That's a ton of points for only 14 turnovers. Western capitalized on every opportunity they had, and as you can see, they capitalized on the very last one. I thought for a second the Catamounts had thrown the ball away there at the end, but they managed to keep possession with about 4 seconds left, give somebody a chance, and Mike Brown took that chance and made the absolute most of it. It's going to be one that nobody in here is going to forget that, because that was a truly special shot.
I can truly say that was probably one of the best Catamount game, probably the best Catamount game I've seen. A close game from beginning to end. The biggest lead, I think, either way was 4 points. About 20 lead changes and ties. It was just a great game here. The fans got a great game on senior day here, and it's a thriller. A great game.
Absolutely, Western sent the seniors out with a bang. There were 12 lead changes and 16 ties, which is very impressive. No team led by more than four, as you said. And that's going to do it for the Catamount All-Access Postgame Show. For Kyle Rush and Trevor James, I'm Caleb Rutherford. Thanks for watching.